Off here with another First Chapter Wednesday for you. Today I will be reading from this very well-loved, well-used book called Hideout. This is relatively new. I believe it came out last year. And it is a like kind of thriller adventure book, which is really cool. It's about a boy named Sam, and he lives in like the deep south, the bayous of Mississippi. And he is given a fishing boat by his dad, and is just kind of like exploring different things like that. And he meets a young boy while he is exploring the swamplands of Mississippi, and it kind of leads him on another adventure. So today I'll be reading you Hideout by Watt Key. Chapter 1. I slowed my skiff at the mouth of the Bluff Creek and started over the Pascagoula River. The far shore was a looming wall of cypress trees and densely tangled underbrush, casting a long morning shadow over the black water. I set aside my new fishing rod and pulled a map of Jackson County, Mississippi from my pocket. I spread it on the seat and studied it. The Pascagoula River Delta was a broad, uninhabited marsh, indicated by a swath of green and hashed as wetlands. There were no other markings on the map for miles except a few red dots that I assumed were the old fishing camps. There were no roads and no way into the place except by small boat, and somewhere in that enormous swamp was a dead body. Dad had mentioned the swamp to me a few times, sort of like you'd talk about the moon. It was a place looked at from a distance, a mysterious place one never imagines going to. I fished in the Delta once or twice with your granddad when I was a kid, he said. Back then, you'd see people out there. That was before the conservation groups brought up the land and condemned the camps. It's easy to get lost. Cell phones don't work, you get in a fix, and it's a long way to help. I studied the river again. I had my flotation vest on in case I fell overboard or sank. I had a flare kit and a whistle in case I broke down. Dad is chief of police for Pascagoula, and he had made sure I had every possible safety item. The only thing I didn't have was his permission to leave Bluff Creek. He never actually said how far I could go, considering I'd only gotten the boat a week before on my 12th birthday, and I wasn't the type of kid you'd expect to do foolish things. I doubt it crossed his mind that I would venture far from home, but I wasn't the kid I used to be. Even though school had been out for a while, the fight stayed over me like a blanket of sickness that seemed impossible to get out from under. The school counselor told me I'd feel better over time, but I didn't believe him. When I talked to his calm face and tried to tell him what I was feeling, all I could think was that he couldn't possibly understand. Forget the physical pain, it was the humiliation that hurt the most. So I just started telling him and my parents what they wanted to hear. That I was fine. That I no longer thought about it. That the session stopped and I was left to figure it out all for myself. There's not much to figure out. Trying to make friends in a new town is already hard. Add getting beat senseless in front of the entire school and things look hopeless. For a couple of miles, the river was nothing but a winding, featureless ditch of rich tannin-soaked water between cypress trees and savannas of tall buggy whips and marsh grass. Eventually, I passed a creek that entered from my right. I remembered it from the map and kept going. From what I'd seen on the news, search and rescue, or SNR as Dad called it, had mostly been in the Ward Bayou Wildlife Management Area, still a few miles north of me. They'd found the abandoned John boat sunk in the gunwales, streaked with blood, drifting slowly down the river. As my outboard engine raced on and home fell farther behind, fear swelled inside me. I came to a fork in the river, stopped, swallowed against the fear, and calmed myself. I pulled out the map again and located where I was, just outside the management area. The right fork would take me directly into it. There's no way you can get lost, I told myself. It's just one fork in the river. I put away the map and sped up, forcing myself to press on. Now there wasn't even a distant cell tower or power line visible over the trees, making the river feel even more remote and empty. Maybe if I'd seen another boat along the way, I would have felt safer. Then I thought it was better that no one saw me, but mostly I thought this was the dumbest thing I'd ever done. I soon came to another creek, entering the east. That was as far as I could make myself go. On the map, it was called Ware Bayou. I'll explore just this one. I won't even go deep into it. There's no way I can get lost after just two turns. I motored into the mouth and the cypress trees closed on both sides of me. They were seemingly taller, as if the swamp grew stronger the deeper into the heart of a person it went. Spanish moss hung from the branches like the beards of old men. Beneath was a tangled thicket of palmettos and cane, swollen to an impenetrable wall of green with the wet June heat. The smell of air was heavy and thick like steamed vegetables. The foliage looked like a jungle, but I heard no bird or animal sounds. It was quiet and still. I heard nothing but my heart beating heavily in my chest and up into my ears. As I motored slowly into the mouth, the water cleared to a dark tea color. With the creek curving out of sight before me, I visualized the map, remembering the countless creeks and sloughs that in turn split off into more creeks and sloughs. A feeling of defeat settled over me as I contemplated what I was truly up against. This was just one of maybe 100 waterways I'd have to explore. Unlike SNR, I did not have a helicopter and night vision scopes and real search vessels. It was going to be impossible to find a dead body in this place, especially after everyone had already searched for 5 days and given up. I looked down beside the boat, examining the dark-colored depths. I thought about the corpse rising up from the bottom, bloated and yellowish-looking like I'd seen in a horror movie. What would I do if I found it? Seeing it would be enough. Then I'd report it. Then I'd be on the news and everyone would know it. Dad would be so impressed with me that he wouldn't care that I'd taken my boat so far from home. Suddenly, the foot of my outboard motor slammed into something and shut off. Fear raced up my spine again as I spun and looked at the water behind me. I saw the tip of an old piling just inches beneath the surface. Dad called them deadheads, and the description had never sounded so fitting. As I slowly drifted past the deadhead, my mind flashed with visions of being stranded in such a place. Then something splashed to my left and startled me. I looked just in time to see an 8-foot-long alligator disappear into the depths. It seemed the place wasn't so empty and still after all. I imagined all sizes of those alligators crouched within that green wall of tangle, watching me. All right, so that is chapter one of Hideout. Really good story. You can order it from the library on Destiny or get it on Overdrive. Ms. Cleaver, we'll see you next week with another First Chapter Wednesday. Have a great week.